serve a great and wonderful God. Amen. He's a great God. Shout, great God. Amen. You can return to your seat if you have your Bible. Amen. I don't know why I feel directed to preach what I'm going to preach. I don't know if I've ever preached from this text the way this is going to unfold. See where it goes. Already the lights are dimming, whatever that means. Amen. Somebody's feeling, I don't know what. Hallelujah. He's a great God. Psalm 37. And verse number 1. Are you glad for all of our guests that are here tonight? If you don't want to miss Tuesday, we're going to have a great time. I'm looking forward to it. Also, continue to pray for the Wilbanks family, the loss of this wonderful pastor's wife, Sister Karen Wilbanks, in Coleman, Alabama. And it's a tragic story. Went for Mother's Day with her husband to Michigan to see her mother-in-law. Got to feeling bad, went to the doctor. They admitted her into the hospital with gallbladder issues. And she never left the hospital and passed away. Just a tragedy and a very painful process that not only family and extended family, but also that church, not even being able to grieve, if you will, or visit their pastor's wife because of the distance. And so we are going to pray. I will be flying out on Wednesday to be in the funeral, and I'm praying for the family. How many will lift your hand and say, I'll pray for the Wilbanks family in that church in this time of need? Amen. Many people are already en route. Bishop and Sister Wilson on their way encountered severe weather and very difficult. In fact, I think their plane was the only one that was allowed to land at the airport during that period of time. And so we're glad for God's traveling mercies with them. Amen. Sister Young, I think, leaves tomorrow to go be with Sister Mondelez and Sister Tiffany and the family. And we'll be there on Wednesday for the funeral. Amen. But I tell you what, God reigns. These are the days of Elijah. That means stuff's happening. That means the word of God is being declared. And if you know anything about the days of Elijah, when things started happening, there were miracles, there were signs, there were wonders. And I believe that God is demonstrating his power, and I believe that we have access into the supernatural tonight. If you believe it, shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Psalm 37, verse number 1. Fret not thyself because of evil. Neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity. For they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. I want to preach, trust God. He's got this. Trust God. He's got this. Give somebody a high five and say, you need to trust God because he's got this. Give him one more hand clap of praise before you're seated. Come on and shout. Lift your voice. Let five people overhear your voice. Come on, some of you ain't shouting. Come on, shout with that voice. Praise God. Praise God. You may be seated. Amen. If you have paid much attention, you would acknowledge that our world is becoming interesting at the very least. It is becoming stranger to Christian people than ever before. And it is a time of tumultuous events. There are our planet, and that there are wickednesses, if that's such a word, there are wicked things, there are troubles, there are new diseases, they are warning us that due to the amount of antibiotics that we have taken over our lifetime, which is a new thing for humans in the last 100 years, that bodies that were made to fight infections naturally, now because of all those antibiotics that we have taken, sometimes when needed and sometimes when we didn't, that we have created issues with immunity that will give rise to new superbugs or super diseases that are going to affect the body to which we don't have answers. I'm not a doctor, I don't understand all of that, but if you read enough stuff, it'll make you get worried. And I look around at our world, there is divisions, there is wickedness, there is sin, there is evil, there is injustice, there is manipulation, there is, the list goes on. If you wanted to just worry your way into a funk, just get online and type the world's troubles. And you will still be reading this time next Sunday, and you will be so depressed, and you will be so fretful, and you will be so worried about what's going to happen to you and to your children and your grandchildren. And then, to add to the issues, I call them the hyenas. I've been to Africa, I've been to the Samburu, and I've been to the Masamara and the Serengeti, and I got to tell you, I think the ugliest creatures that God ever made are hyenas. And it's their attitude I don't like. In fact, if they'd have listened to me, I'd have talked to them when I was in Africa the last time. They just have a way of hanging around looking for the victim. Have you ever noticed that? They don't have the strength of a lion unless they get enough of them to gang up on an old lion that's a little weak. And they just hang around waiting on some victim to go down or some little antelope to get separated, and they wait for the lion to make the kill, and then they just kind of wait for trouble. And I'm looking around in our world, there's a lot of hyenas out there. They're playing off of other people's suffering. They're playing off of issues and stirring it up, and they don't have the guts to do anything for themselves except they just kind of hang out waiting for an opportunity to profit off of somebody else's issue. In fact, I did some study recently. As you know, my efforts have been concerned with and research for doctoral studies have been about the third world, the developing world, and issues of sociology and what happens. And to my chagrin, I have been so shocked in those studies through the years to discover how much money is made under the brand called aid that never gets to the people that the money is raised for. It's not just a few dollars. It's millions and millions of dollars that people are lining their pockets with based off of the sufferings of other people. During the most recent issues in Haiti a few years back, the devastating earthquake, I have friends that do extended ministry there from orphanages to help and so on and so forth. I had a friend that got on the plane, had to work a thousand things to even get there. He wanted to be on the ground as quickly as possible, began to work everything he could. Electricity was down, getting a hold of satellite phones, calling people in the United States, getting money, getting meals, getting them on boats, getting them on planes, getting them into Haiti. And he told me he was so angry, he was so frustrated. He said, "Miles, it made me so mad." He said, "I went down to the docks and there were boats that were sitting there with food that was rotting. It rotted on the boat in the port in Haiti.
that I have personally had to study for college and university and doctoral level studies. It would blow your mind the manipulation and the corruption. I've been driving in Central America down beautiful roads, and suddenly the road ends for no apparent reason at all. And you ask and you begin to research what happened to the road. And they said, oh, there was $100,000 donated by the UN to build this road, but the so-and-so guy that's in charge of this area pocketed the money and never built the road. And if you dwell on those things, some of you are getting mad right now. It will stir you up. You will get so angry. You will get so focused as you see as politicians manipulate poor people and the young handing out bread. It's like Rome of old. They got elected by throwing parties and games and giving food, and they got elected, and you watch as people with a lack of education, a lack of understanding are swept into the flow of, here, just give me a little of this. I rolled through Kibera when we were in Kenya a couple of months ago. We were there with Bishop Aston, and we were rolling through the largest slum in Africa. And he said, you wouldn't believe, Pastor Young, he said, it's this slum that elects people. I said, what do you mean? He said, because whenever there's an election, he said, all the officials come to Kibera. He said, and they begin to hand out money, and they begin to hand out little prizes and little clothes, and they get a following, never knowing that the moment they're elected office, he said, they'll never be back here again until election season comes around. And they promise, because suffering has become big business. Great engines of benevolence seek to bottle up the world's grief, but in the process it becomes profit scheme. And I'm going this way because I want to get you stirred up a little bit. I want you recognizing those emotions that you're feeling right now. Every day I wake up, has anybody besides me noticed that it's like every day there's a new controversy? I wake up and you turn on the radio, turn on the internet, you pick up the paper, you go to the coffee shop, and everybody's talking about this new situation. There's a new scandal. Some politician took a bribe. Some educator's been taking advantage of the students. Some producer and actor's been sexually exploiting the followers that are trying to make it in the market. Some televangelist has been milking the church for members while having secret affairs. Man, this service is getting depressing even as I'm preaching. The Bible lets you know that the world is full of evil doers. There's evil in education. There's evil in politics. There's evil in security. There's evil in benevolence. There's even evil in pulpit. There's not a lot of preachers preaching about that, but I am tonight. And if we let ourselves get focused, it'll drive you to drink. Some of you didn't have to drive very far. And as a righteous man, I want to do everything I can to make things right. Because that's what it seems like you're supposed to do, right? You want to right what's been wrong. You want to kill every giant. You want to march in every cause. You want to avenge every victim. And yeah, there are places and there are processes and there are people that are equipped and trained and can lead us. And when there's time to act, we act. But I can't just rush forward without stopping for a moment and sin. This is a sin fighting church. How many know that to be true? But if you think I wake up every morning trying to find what I can preach against, you're smoking crack. The first thing on my mind is not what's wrong with the world today. The first thing that ought to be in an apostolic mind, it ought, when you wake up, the first thing that comes to your brain should be, God reigns. God reigns. I may face hell. I may go through injustice. I may go through trouble. I may go through financial heartache. I may go through new diseases from antibiotics I took. But God ain't in trouble. Ain't nothing wrong with God's power. Ain't nothing weak about His virtue. I'm not going to lose my mind over what's wrong in the world. I'm going to get my attention on Jesus. Somebody give a great God some great praise right now. Terrorism strikes fear in
the heart of a man or a woman.
But I want to ask you something. Okay, we're not Republicans, Democrats, Libertarians. We're apostolics. Okay? In this church, there's all of it. So let me time out. Pastor a minute. Pastoral commercial. We're glad you tuned in today. Please don't come politic at the church. Because the guy next to you may be the biggest Obama fan sitting next to the biggest Trump fan. Next to Bernie. Or Hillary. I have seen brothers get in fights over politics, folks. Ain't none of them got the answer. Why don't we leave all that out there and let's just come focus on Jesus when we get in here. Delight thyself in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desire of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Instead of obsessing with everything that's wrong, start obsessing on everything that's right. I promise, there'll be enough trouble show up that you'll have to deal with. You won't have to worry. What, can you imagine being those parents where there was their five-year-old kid went and knocked over that $150,000? Y'all read about that? You talking about trouble. You think you've got problems. Now it looks like that family's going, that mom and dad's going to have to pay for that figurine that got knocked over in that museum. I think I'd be turning my child into a museum piece. You're going to have enough junk just show up in your life that you don't have to go looking for trouble. Trouble knows your address. It knows your phone number. It knows your email. It knows where you go to work. It knows what route you take. Man that is born of a woman, just a few days and you're going to be full of trouble. You don't have to go look for trouble by yourself. It'll get there in plenty of time. So what you've got to do is quit obsessing on all the trouble and focusing on all the evil. And this is, I'm not giving you some little positive mental attitude, sir. What I'm giving you is reality. I'm not the guru of just smile and feel good and everything's going to be all right, honey. God loves you. He does. You may go through hell. Let me see anybody here. You've ever lost money. Guess what? You're going to lose some more. How many have ever had trouble? I'm talking about big trouble coming your home. Guess what? There's more coming. I'm not promising you're going to get rich scheme. I'm not promising you're going to live happily ever after. You may cry your way all the way to glory. But for God's sake, quit fretting over what you cannot control. Why don't you determine in my own life, I'm back to dominion. I'm going to take dominion over my mind, over my life. I can't fix all that. I don't have the power, but what I can do, this is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice in it. I've got a made up mind. My God is great and greatly to be praised. He's beautiful for situation. He reigns. He's in charge, and I'm going to trust him.
Maybe I'm sorry. You're nervous?
Chill, baby. God's got this. Hey, ain't none of us perfect. And to lose our mind over somebody that we think messed up, that's getting a little promotion or getting some kind of recognition that we didn't get, chill. You can lose your spiritual man. You can lose your soul over being envious about what you didn't get that somebody else did. Fret not thyself, verse 7, because of him who prospereth in his way. And you know what his way is. One of the fears I had as an evangelist, I evangelized for about 5.5 years. And I know how it is. Evangelists show up, especially when they're a little rambunctious, and I can get a little rambunctious, and I like to stir things up. And there are people that will start showing off. They want to show the evangelists how good of a worshiper they are. And sometimes, boy, you just give in to it, you go, whoa, why don't all y'all rub eyes like him? Why don't all y'all scream like she does? And everybody in the church is going, yeah, we know who that is. Don't get into that game. Don't fret thyself because of those who are prospering in the way they're going, and you know what way that is. Don't fret because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. I know it can be so frustrating. Let me tell you what preachers get frustrated. It frustrates me to see all these Christian scammers get up and promote, send this amount of money, I'll send you an anointed handkerchief. I'll send you some holy water from a pool of Siloam. Send $500 in the mail. I'll mail it to you, pour it on your shoulder. Your shoulder ain't going to change. You still going to have bursitis. And I don't even know what bursitis is. And meanwhile, we're trying to raise money for it, to put the pavilion roof on, trying to get the prayer room turned into some classes. And we got the new foyer, and now we're getting ready to do the carpet. I'm thinking, God, I know all that junk they do. Bottles of this and handkerchiefs of that and mailing in prayer cards for $5. They're piling them up. I've seen pictures of the dumpsters full of prayer calls that nobody ever prayed for. They send them in and they just send them millions of dollars and they jet setting around the country on this show and that show. And I'm thinking, God, I got little widows that are paying tithes every week and giving, and we're struggling to get this done and that done, and we want to plant churches here. And God, we're just trying. And the Holy Ghost told me, said, quit worrying about all that. I can't fix all that. I can't fix all the hypocrites. Hypocrites are not a new thing. Hypocrites have been around a long time. And as long as the Lord tarries, there's going to be hypocrites in the pulpit. There's going to be hypocrites in the pew. There's going to be hypocrites in the Sunday school class. They're just going to be hypocrites. If you're going to backslide over hypocrites, you're a fool. Because who are you going to run with out there? As if there's no hypocrites out there. They tell you they love you. They don't love you. They just want to sleep with you. Is this too plain? They don't want to buy you a drink. They want to go to bed with you. They're hypocritical. They don't love you. They're going to abuse you and throw you away for the next chick that comes along or the next opportunity. You need to stay in church and say, God, I'm not going to lose my mind over the hypocrites. I'm going to delight myself in you because there's no shadow of turning in you. There's no falsity in you. You never lie. You're not a man that
The original actually says, quit flaring your nostrils. Some of you, if you could just give them a piece of your mind. Some of y'all feel that way right now about somebody in this room. Quit lying. You don't want to give them a piece of your mind. You want to give them a right hook. He said, quit. Shut that anger off. Well, they said this about me. As if you're the only one that anybody's ever said anything about. Cease from anger. Forsake wrath. That means heat, the heat or rage. Fret not. Quit burning with anger. So, let's go the logical end. We'll quit hooping and let's just go logical for a minute, philosophical. So, Josiah Preston has done you wrong. Nostrils flaring. You're feeling that Barabbas spirit get on you. And you're just so angry. He said that about your piano solo. And you're supposed to be doing, you're playing gospel music. How can he talk about my gospel music if he's playing? He's a gospel musician. This is all in theory because musicians never gospel or anything. Or worse, in this account, he stole my lick. You can't take that lick, that's my lick. People get in fights over stupid stuff. But let's make it a real bad deal. So let's logically, let's take it out. Because you're angry, you want to make him pay, and it would feel so good to just, as he's tuning his guitar, to saunter in a little misdirection and go, wham! That feels good, wouldn't it? Quit lying, you know it feels good. You ever just want to punch somebody? I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. Want to cuss somebody out? Want to give somebody a piece of your mind? Okay, let's just do it. I'm kidding, but. Let's say God said you can do it once.
Cheated you and talked about you and abused you. Why don't you just delight yourself?
Delight thyself. Here's what's interesting, Brother Master. I like Brother Master. Brother Master likes good preaching. I don't know if anybody texts me more than Brother Master. He texts me. He not only texts me, well, that was a good sermon. He'll sometimes add a scripture and say, oh, I was thinking about this in relationship to your message. So maybe nobody else is here. It's just me and you. Do you know what delight in the original? I'm going to get one before you find it and text me. Delight has to do with delicacy. It literally is connected. You go do a word study. It has to do with delicacy in the Hebrew. And what it's trying to say is delicate things don't last being mishandled, right? Tupperware you can throw across the kitchen. Try that with China. Won't work. Now, China is much more valuable, but it's very fragile. Tupperware ain't worth much, but man, you can make Frisbees out of dinner plates and eat on it the next day. Believe me, I know, I've done it. But he says, instead of burning in anger with nostrils flared over people that have done you wrong and everything that's going wrong with politics and injustice and life and finances on the job with the kids, with the family, with the brother, all the hypocrites, instead of losing your mind over that, he says, delight. And he uses a word for soft and dainty in the original. In other words, slow down, put your big guns up, put those flaring nostrils, you look like an idiot. Soften up a little bit, dude. We know you can scream. We know you can growl. We know you're a man. Let's hear you roar. We know all that. He says, chill. Fret not thyself. And let God enter the equation. Some of you need to delete your Instagram account. Some of you need to stay off Twitter. You're putting stuff out there that's stupid. You're taking this as dumb stuff. It blows my mind how people fight on the internet and they won't go to each other's house and fight. I got friends from back east, south. I grew up in Louisiana. I have friends that every Thanksgiving they had family fights with the neighbors down the street. It was like, oh, dinner's over, time for the fight. I mean, that's the truth. And if I call their name, you know them, because some of them have preached in this church. I made the mistake of going to Disneyland with about three of the brothers one time. And we have been sitting at, you know, out there front, remember old Fantasia, the water show they do out there? And you got to get there like 3 hours before so you can see water for 25 minutes. And somebody stepped in front of all those rednecks, and they wasn't all preachers. And it was on like Donkey Kong. And I was like, okay, me and Mickey's going to slip out over here. We're going to Pirates of the Caribbean. Some of y'all get stirred up over stupid stuff. You stir each other up. You go gossip to one another. And you just keep rehashing old stuff. You get in fights in the hospital. You get in fights at the funeral. You get in fights at the wedding. Well, I've quit being an evangelist now. I'm a pastor. Stop foaming out your opinion about everything. Well, bless God, this is America. I can do what I want to. Yeah, you're right. This is America. I can preach what I want to, too. You need to shut up. Everybody, you need to get your attention off all the problems and get your mind on God and start delighting in what God is doing. Nobody likes your sourpuss attitude. Nobody likes your griping and your complaining.
Americans are tumultuous tyrants. Our brother justified Jose. I'm trying to cover all the bases. We got one rule tonight. It's real spiritual. No parking on the dance floor. Whether you're the craziest preacher, yeah, you are here. You don't have a clue. If you can't dance and shout tonight, you just sit there and bebop in the pew. A tap a foot, or give me a Baptist nod, or a Methodist wave. But for some Pentecostal crazy worship.